Welcome to Fiber Trek. My name is Sarah. Today is January 14th, 2016. Happy New Year. Thank you so much for returning viewers and those of you that are new. It's great to have people investing their time into craft and making, and I appreciate you taking some of your time to share with me. So I'm probably going to be filming this in parts today. I have works in progress, spinning, I have some sewing, I have Shackleton, I have prize drawing within Shackleton, and I'm hoping to add a segment on the Lucette that I've been using, and I'll talk a little bit more about Lucettes and why I've chosen to bring that into my making realm, and you'll see probably my sound decision making. So I just saw a blue jay land on the deck and slip and skid across it, so try not to be distracted. Speaking of birds, I almost wasn't able to record today. It's been in my to-do list for a while now. I've started back to school and commuting and settling into this new routine. And so today I just wrapped my first week and I was like, yay, I'm going to be around. And I was driving home, and this is a little public service announcement for those of us living in the Northern Hemisphere, where there's a lot of snow and sand trucks and country roads, etc. It doesn't happen so much on the interstates. But the songbirds and other birds tend to gather in the sanded roads to pick up sand and gravel. And these tend to be, around here at least, large flocks of goldfinch and crossbills. And I think I can get a picture for you of crossbills. Crossbills are really cool, and that's exactly, the description is exactly what to expect with a crossbill. They have bills that are crossed. I tend not to see them down at this end of where I live, but as you get up towards the Golden Road, which is a privately run logging road with lots of gravel, and in towards the park, they tend to be a little bit more prevalent. But let me see if I can find a picture of them, because they're really cool. The whole point of this discussion, though, is to make you aware that we do lose a good portion of our songbird population to drivers, and the birds tend to not move in flocks and get caught up in backdraft and twirled around, and sometimes that doesn't kill them, but they end up in shock, and then they aren't able to flee or fly away when the next round of cars comes through. So today, I was driving home, and of course I saw the flocks. I tend to go slow and use my horn. I know, I'm just such an old lady that way. And when I passed this one flock, a bunch of them took off, but two didn't. And I had a car behind me, so I kept driving and turned around and went back and grabbed the two of them. They were still alive. And so they're sitting in my kitchen in a box with a towel and in the dark. And I called the main Aviary Haven, which is a really awesome nonprofit located in Freedom, Maine. They have a network of volunteers around the state. So I called them and I have arranged for a pickup. A chain of volunteers will get them down to the hospital. I have one that is very feisty right now, so he's come round or she's come round from that shock. Sometimes they just, if they hit your windows or you pick them up in these instances, what happens is a lot of times their body is in shock, and then they end up getting too cold and they die of hypothermia. So a lot of times when I have birds that hit windows or that I find in distress, a lot of times I'll pick them up in my hands and warm them. And then most of the time they come back round. So I'll stand for 15, 20 minutes. And I also will bring them in the house, put them in a dark box, obviously with ventilation, on a towel, no food or water, unless instructed. And then I called Main Haven, and this one little guy is eyes open, head up, body kind of listing, so I'm kind of concerned. But again, still heartened because we're probably two and a half hours into the rescue, and the bird is stable. So I'm going to transport him and his buddy, or her and her buddy, or them, with a volunteer in Medway. So I'll drive about half an hour in a little bit and drop them off, and they'll make their way down to the bird hospital. So my public service announcement, I don't tend to really like to do this type of thing because I'm not really interested in dictating to anybody my set of my agenda or my biases. But should you feel that there's an opportunity to watch out for nature in your life, this is a great way to do it in this part of the world. It's just to slow down and watch these flocks. I'm not saying you have to pick up birds and save them. That can be a natural consequence. Should you feel so inclined, I can recommend the Maine Aviary Hospital, and I'm sure other states have these bird hospitals. What's really nice is they don't just save the big birds. They don't just save the raptors, the majestic birds. They also will take these songbirds, and they'll take ducks, robins, jays. They're very interested in managing the bird populations and looking out for them. And so, you know, you can fall in that spectrum of thoughtfulness any way you want. And if it doesn't matter to you, then it doesn't matter. And we all have our things that we choose to champion. So the Red Crossbill, 530. Let me just show you a picture of these beautiful birds. It's funny, I don't talk a lot about birds in my personal life. It tends to be something that I simply enjoy with my husband. But somehow on the podcast, I always end up talking about birds and wool. I don't know what that's about. But they tend to come along in my little life, I guess, at the right time when we're talking. I've also had pine grosbeaks, and those are very cool. So this is the Red Crossbill. I've also had the white winged. So there's the Red Crossbill. This is the Sibley Guide to Birds by David Allen Sibley. And this is the white winged. And they have that beautiful flush of red. And if I can get really close, you can see, can you see the crossbill on that illustration? There it is. So anyway, I saw one of those. They were able to make an escape from my vehicle. So I'm going to be, I think the whole point of that digression was that I'm going to be filming in segments. So right now I'm going to do a portion, and I really hope I can finish it up and get it out to you. I know it's been a few weeks. So I think I'm going to launch right in. I did welcome you all, and I would also like to, as an addendum to that, let you know how much I appreciate all of the conversation and activity that's happening in the Shackleton thread, and those of you that have reached out, that have corresponded through Instagram, that have tuned in and watched and subscribed to the channel. If you are new to FiberTrek, we do have a Ravelry group, and that is FiberTrek on Ravelry. And we are typically chatting in the Shackleton thread, which is a great thread for anybody looking to just dive into something new. You don't have to participate the whole length of time, but I'll talk more about that in Shackleton. So I'm back, and I wanted to do some introductions to be included in the beginning of the podcast. And really, I like to highlight the people who introduce themselves and just kind of give you a little insight into the spice of our group. So I had Catherine Louise introduce herself. She's living in Austria. She's originally from Colorado and has joined the Shackleton along. She did a fiber trek to New Zealand and seriously pimped out her stash, she said. And I thought about doing a fiber trek to New Zealand, and I was like, oh my God, I don't know if there's a boat big enough to get all my stuff home. But the idea of going to New Zealand thrills me to the fibery core. I had Smash Williams, 94, introduce herself. She's from Florida. She has the Yarn Reader podcast, and you can certainly go link with her in Ravelry. Glass Beetle, fellow Mainer. So excited to see another Mainer in the group. And she has similar fiber trek interests to myself. So welcome, Glass Beetle. And then I have Annie Zett, who is from the UK, and she's thinking about joining us in the Shackleton Along. And she has fleece processing aspirations. And her son is traveling in Antarctica. So I thought, well, you'd have to do it, right? I mean, you have all of these things coming together for you. So that was really exciting. So welcome. Thank you so much for taking the time to introduce yourself in the group. So let's just start with works in progress, because I have no finished objects. I'm going to try and use my iPad and give you some visuals of the projects I'm working on. I did deviate a little bit from my typical behavior in 2016, I've cast on quite a few projects. I'm working on three. And I'm working on some secret knitting that I didn't realize this, but one of my friends actually watches this podcast from time to time. And so I don't want to spoil some of the work I've been doing for her and her new baby. So I'm working on the Winter Wonder Shawl by Helen Stewart, and I'm very much enjoying it. This is a couple options for this particular shawl, which includes some beading, and I won't be doing that. And here it is. I don't know. Let me look. Oh, yeah. I'm always like this, aren't I? Hello. So there it is. What really attracted me to this pattern is that mesh lace in with the garter. And when I saw that mesh lace, I immediately thought of this particular yarn. I can hear the birds. One is, he's like, I'm done, like, let me out. But I have opted to send them together for my anthropomorphic ways. The other guy who doesn't feel as well, I think that they're more comforted with, you know, their flock mate. So they are flock animals, and so I would hate to separate them out. So this is, here we go. This is Rose. This is a singles fingering, and Rose is my sheep. And so I thought this would be beautiful for the mesh portion of that. I'm going to try and center myself because sometimes I think I'm out of focus, but I do like being on the side. So this is going to be the mesh portion, which was really the inspiration. And then I decided to, I had originally was going to use this Cornish 10 for a pair of Agatha socks by Claire of New Hampshire Knits. And I have since found two skeins of Jacob from Jenny Gemp Farm that I bought at Maryland that I think will be perfect. They are, of course, gray. And I decided to use the Cornish tin for the body of the shawl. So we have these two together. It's gray. Just don't be alarmed. It's gray. And then this is the progress I've made. I love this. It's totally meditative. You know, back and forth. I'm really enjoying Helen's increases on this side. There's a specific way she has you do these that I've never done before, and I like the way they look. They're even, and it's got really nice stretch. So I am really enjoying this project, and I like Helen's aesthetic. I loved her theme for the knit vent this year, and I feel like it is very much reflected, no pun intended. I think part of her theme was light in the project. So that is on the needle. That is on the needles, and it's been traveling with me to class. The other thing I have on the needles is the Tucker sweater, and I had taken a little hiatus because I had cast on the wrong amount of stitches, and so I had to rip the whole thing out, and I felt like such a dope. And then I took a hiatus from it, and I'm back on track, making my way through with good speed. And so here it is. It's got a cable neck, and that is by, I think it's Amanda Schersker. And I'm doing it simply, I don't know, wait for it. It's a beautiful Lincoln yarn that I picked up from Maine Yarn and Fiber Supply last Christmas. And it is so nice. I've talked about it before. It's got some beautiful density and luster to it. And it is just stunning. It is my kind of yarn. Long wools, gray, yeah. And it's nice and heavy. It's not your typical, I don't know, I'm not saying that, I'm speaking out of turn. But I like the heft of it. It's not a fingering lace weight, which sometimes can capture the beauty of those long wools. So I'm working on that. And then I have my secret knitting. So those are the three projects. And I'm thinking about casting on another one. I have aspirations of participating in the Natural Shades Knit Along with Brit Yarn. And the details of that knit along, which began today, are in the Brit Yarn Ravelry group in the thread. And I also know that Knit British has chatted about them on her podcast. I need to figure out what I'm going to do, and it shouldn't be a hard thing for me, right? Natural shades. So I think you need to use 3 shades, and it needs to be something wearable. So I'm going to rack my brain a little bit this weekend while I think about how to participate. The other knit along I'm going to go post in is Emily of Fibertown has the Cozy knit along, and I think this is more about, you know, feeling cozy and talking about what you're knitting in January and perhaps why you're knitting it. So I encourage you to go check both those out. I probably can use them interchangeably because nothing makes me feel more cozy than natural shades, right? More warm and fuzzy. No pun intended. Is that the second time I've said that today? I think that's it for whips. I'm going to talk about some finished objects in my that I've been sewing. Well, let's go to spinning. So I got the Herdwick off the wheel. I was going to ply it. I was like, oh yeah, I know how to ply it. Put on my lazy cape. No way, man. This stuff was like, it would come off the bobbins and then tangle. And so I wasn't able to keep tension on it to make that ply work. So I was like, all right, we're going with singles on this one. So I've kept it singles, and this is for the Knit British Breed Swatch Along. I got 2 skeins. One is 192 yards and one is 140 yards. That's a total weight of about 9 ounces. So it's a pretty hefty singles. There's a lot of weight in it. It's very dense. You can see the kemp coming off that. I need to knit this and make some observations and record some things, and then knit my swatch, etc., to participate with Louise in her swatch along. So I think I will knit my swatch, and then I have aspirations of using this on my Lucette. And I just brought that with some basic, we'll see if this will work. This is just a piece of scrap, but this is a Lucette. And it is a mid-century, a medieval tool that, and also a Scandinavian tool. Although when I came to history, they didn't really have a lot of information on anything, any archaeological finds. And so I opted to not talk too much about it because I just couldn't verify my information. But really what I'm making is kind of a square I-cord. And this is from Stephen Willett, and I just pull it over, I don't know if you can see that, and over the prong, back over, and his Lucettes come with instructions, and so you can certainly learn to do that through the photographic instructions. The thing about what this does is it makes cordage, if you will. And what I was able to glean off the internet from a particular blog and some other writing was that this cordage was used to attach things to yourself, to your belt, pockets, that type of thing. And it kind of went out of fashion from what I understand in medieval Europe and then resurged again in the Renaissance. But basically what you're making is square cord. And I think about cordage a lot, rope, cordage, what that allowed people to do. Is that coming through at all? And, you know, you think about rope, sails, the ability to lash things down, lash things together, build shelter, and the ramifications that could have on a population or, you know, the success of a group, etc. So just something interesting to think about. I mean, I think about fire the same way and the impacts fire had on survival. And then the impacts, of course, that just something as simple as cordage. Like I can tie things together. I can build. I can manipulate structure and shape. Just kind of something interesting. So I'm going to use that Herdwick, which is a conservation breed of sheep from Britain, to do some cordage work. And I thought I might make a cordage and then stitch it together and make a stool out of it. My bird is going crazy. So I finished the Herdwick. I got my Lucette going. I'm feeling good. I got to get my swatch knit up for Louise. And then while I had that plying head on my Lendrum, I decided that I would finish up some plying that needed to be done. So very early on in my podcasting career, I was gifted from Deb of Fond and Fiber, who is such a prolific dyer and participant in the spinning and dyeing community, a samples pack, a breed samples pack. And I have worked my way through it. This is the Jacob. So this is, it's very dark. So this is the British Jacob. And I finished that little sample and it's lovely. And I'm in love with that. Is that coming through? And then I also finished the samples for my Leicester long wool. I'm going to knit a swatch for the Pebble Beach Shellette by Helen Stewart. I had earmarked this fleece for that particular project when I first saw that pattern come out. I was very excited to see Brian Heath or Devin of Tiny Paper Foxes. I've been watching them. Very excited to see the work that he's decided to do with conservation breeds in the United States. So if you are interested in learning more about spinning and breed-specific yarns, not just the experience of spinning it, but knitting and dyeing, then I would encourage you to go check out Tiny Paper Foxes. They gave me a very nice shout-out a couple weeks ago through the work of this of the breed wool, and so that was really fun to hear highlighted on their very popular podcast. So this is my Leicester long wool, and I'm knitting for spinning for a heavy lace light fingering, and I'm not really sure that's gonna, you can probably pick up some of the luster there, and I don't know. I really would love to embrace some of the work that Rachel of Woolen Spinning Podcast does. My husband is picking me up some cards at the hardware store, and I just watched the beginning of her latest episode, and maybe becoming a little bit more intentional about how I spin and documentation of that. So thank you so much, Rachel, for giving me that kind of boost in the right direction for just structuring my spinning a little bit more. I'm very intuitive in how I spin, and I have a default. Heather of Highland Handmaids, the Fiberista Files, talked a little bit about her default, and man, am I a default spinner. My feet go, my hands go, this is what you get, this is what it is. And I was thinking about Rachel finished the a shawl by Annie Claire, I think, which I had earmarked in my queue. And I've also earmarked her other one, which is the Isle of Purbeck shawl, which is, I think, a knit with a DK weight. And I have some beautiful brown Manx Lockton upstairs. And I also have some beautiful bats that were hand carded by Michelle of Bybrook Farm from her next door neighbor, Sheep Persia, that has no real lineage. But man, what a fleece. Definitely a long wool. And so I was thinking, oh, I wonder if I could make that work. And so when I was listening to Rachel, I started to get a little bit of like, I could make a point to do that. You know, I could make that a little bit of a challenge, see if I can firm up that spinning knowledge a little bit. So that's the Leicester long wool. That sampling is done. I could even make a card for it and write down some things about it. I have on the wheel, which I'm so psyched to have back on, which is the Flat Island Fleece of 2015. This is a fleece that's from Starcroft and Nash Island. They reserve so many fleeces of hand spinning quality every year, and Flat Island has color on it. So she's got grays and dark black and etc. And there's a little bit of Scottish blackface history in this particular fleece, and it has come through a bit, and I love it. But here it is, default spinning, nothing special. But I'm going to spin up this fleece and do a three ply. So first bobbin. Second bobbin's on the wheel. And I think that's it for spinning. So for sewing, I finished two items this holiday. And the first is the Esme top, and that is a Sew Liberated pattern. I picked this fabric up at Martin's, which is a kind of, it's not a secondhand shop, but it's a discount store, and they get beautiful fabrics discounted, like people moving their lines out, going bankrupt, etc. That's where this merchandise goes. So I picked up this Wyndham Fabrics at Martin's for like $4 a yard, which is fantastic. I'm going to peek and make sure you're, there we go. And this is, again, the Esme top. And then these are the, you see the buttons? Yeah. And I like the way it fits for the most part. It seems to have a bit of too much room in the back. Like the front fits and then there's like all of this excess fabric in the back. So I want to kind of work that out a little bit. And I got my facings down. And this placket, gathering, sleeves. I was really happy with the way it turned out. So that is off the machine, as they say. And then I also finished my first schoolhouse tunic. Again, this was part of that initial purchase of the Martin's. Sorry, I thought I heard, I was like, oh my God, the bird's out of the box. Wouldn't that be cool? Came over and sat in the tree with us. Probably not, because then I'd have to catch it in here, which would be no fun. So this is the schoolhouse tunic, and again, my Martin's discount fabric. It's great to have these discount shops with nice fabric, so you can make a sample, and only I've invested, I think I got this for $4 a yard, so, you know, $10. This is the shirt length, and there's a box pleat in the back. I really liked this pattern a lot. I like the way it fits. It fits really quite well. And I don't feel like I need to make any major adjustments to it. I wore it out in public. I was comfortable. And yeah, it felt like a piece of actual clothing. It didn't feel like, oh, I kind of made this and everything's kind of lumpy bumpy. So it just felt smart. And yeah, so I have another one cut out of some nicer fabric. And that is a cotton and steel canvas, which is an 85% cotton, 15% linen. And they're mint. It's a mint. Mint is the colorway, sprinkles or something. So I'm going to be working on that. So those are my finished objects. Right. I think that's all the reporting I'm going to do for now. I'm going to get ready to take the birds for their ride, which should be interesting since that involves getting the dogs walked first. Getting ready, I'm going to take the birds and then go right to skiing and then come home and do some work and finish recording the rest of the podcast. With any luck, there'll still be some light. Righto. So, until my next clip, I'll see you soon. Hello, I'm back. The birds are delivered. It's the next day. I seem to be coming down with something, so I'm going to move through this review gently, because you can already hear me clearing my throat. I wanted to, first off, talk a little bit about reviews in general. I'm just pulling up my information so I can relay it to you. I don't necessarily consider this a review because I'm not interested in hard critique and looking at the design world and how it fits in. And I know a lot of people are doing reviews and they have a lot to offer. So I was thinking about how I could expand on that conversation based on the work and the interest of FiberTrek. And the one thing that came to mind was a conversation about translating designs into more of the micro mill, small producer, curated yarns kind of medium. I talk a lot about medium in this podcast. It tends to be how I come to the craft. Like, what am I working with? Where did it come from? What does it have to offer? How is it prepared? Those are the interests for me more than necessarily design. So I really wanted to take that angle when I was looking at this particular collection. So I think this is going to be more of a conversation and maybe provide a little bit of insight into how I approach patterns and starting a pattern and choosing yarn for a pattern. And of course, this is not a one-way conversation, and I would invite you to comment on it as well. Like, how do you substitute and translate, you know, commercial patterns into this one run fleece that's been curated, it's never going to happen again, and it, you know, so how do we kind of work within those parameters? So I thought I would use this collection by Katia Frankel to kind of talk a little bit about that. What I really, really like about it, which is why I feel like it lends itself to this conversation, is it's a compilation of accessories. And I feel that accessories are a great way to explore and expand your fiber knowledge, your fiber content, your medium. So let's get started. I'm going to tell you a little bit about what Katia has to say about the designs, and then I'll go ahead and show you the patterns. So Katia Frankel is a UK-based knitwear designer known for her inventive yet classic designs for women and children. She is the author of 2 books and is regularly featured in knitting magazines around the world. All right. So this particular collection is the 2015 Autumn Essentials Flatland collection. And in this particular design work, she has taken her fascination with geometrical shapes to a new level. Adventures in Geometry. Inspired by a Victorian science fiction novel called Flatland, in which 2D shapes strive to a higher degree of regularity, or in their words, perfection, Katia has played with stitch patterns and clever shaping to create 3 brand new designs that each explore geometrical concepts. The collection features 3 patterns which use 2D structures within 3D wearable objects by means of stitch patterns and clever shaping. It's available on Ravelry as an ebook for £4.95 or as single patterns. So right there on Ravelry, downloadable, easily accessible. And you can buy it as a single pattern, as she stated. I love that. I have to admit, I definitely like the single pattern option because not all patterns appeal to my aesthetic. So let's take a look. Here we go. Flatland by Katia Frankel. So the first pattern is a hat. Just vector, includes a pom-pom. It includes some ribbing and some pearl texture diamonds in the body of the hat. It's knit with Knit Picks swish worsted, and she gives a substitution yardage for worsted weight yarn, which I think is really helpful. That happens throughout all 3 of the accessories. She also gives you a rundown of the skills that will be needed or acquired while knitting the hat. So in this instance, for example, knitting in the round, knit and purl pattern from written instructions or charts, and decreases. So when I looked at this hat, I immediately wanted to work with 13 Mile Lamb and Wool Company yarn. This is a 2-ply. They have sport and worsted, they have a plant dyed shade selection, and they have a natural shade selection. It's 2-ply, has a light twist, which means it, you know, it's got a little bit more, it's a little bit more relaxed yarn, doesn't have a lot of tight structure to it, and so a little bit more loft and a little bit more drape. So when I'm using that word drape, I don't want you to be like, oh my god, it's gonna be like falling down on my face. But it's gonna have just a little bit more ability to, you know, hang out. And this hat has a little bit of that slouch to it. The yarns that are used for 13 Mile Lamb and Wool Company tend to be on the longer side. I feel like they're more of a Romney, Blueface Lestery. So they're gonna have a some crimp, but they're going to be more of a long wool luster. So they're kind of that in between. So I think you get the warmth and you get the loft and you get the durability. And that's just a nice way to kind of be introduced into some micro mill American yarns. So for me, I thought that would be a great yarn to do that vector hat in. Let's see. The thing is, and I caveat all of these recommendations, I'm kind of a swatcher, but, and I think particularly for this, I would probably swatch with a little bit of the 13 mile lamb because it is a little bit of a lighter worsted depending on how you knit. So you may be able to go up in size needle or down in size needle and up in size for instruction. But for me, it's always going to come down to what do I want to work with? And so does it really come down always to a color or colorway, but what's the medium going to be? What's, you know, what am I looking for? And in this particular case, I want to work with a farm yarn. I want to work with these like heathery colors and the nat and the plant dyed shades, and I want to be in touch with Montana. So that's why I probably would pick that one. The next one is the Tesseract, which is a cowl. It's quite a big cowl. It's got a lot of movement going on. It almost looks like a little bit of entrelac happening, just for those of you who are listening. It goes all the way down to almost her midsection in this particular picture. Pictures are helpful. They do provide a lot of product detail. When I saw this, I really thought about using some singles. This is a garment that doesn't get a lot of wear, so it doesn't need a lot of necessarily tensile strength to reduce pilling. And so those singles, they don't have a lot of twist in them, right? And so they tend to, you know, fibers tend to fly away, and that's what leads to pilling that's coming out of the structure of the yarn. But in this particular instance, wrapping this around your face doesn't really have those wear spots like a garment does, or your mitts. So I was thinking about Icelandic Lopi. Now, a lot of people may balk at that, like using Icelandic up near your face, but for me, that doesn't necessarily haunt my sensory, if you will. And the Lopi that I've seen prepared both by Maine Yarn and Fiber Supply and another farm in this state have all been really soft and lofty. And so I don't think I'd have a problem working with that and having that around my face. I also could take, I took a look at Greenbow Farm because they have an Icelandic flock and they're producing an American Lopi. And theirs too seem to retain some of that gorgeous, lofty plushness about it that I've seen in some of the Lopis that are here. So I really thought about singles. It's two for this. I then was thinking, well, we're looking at accessories. You know, you obviously could knit this in a superwash merino. She knit it in a 80% wool, 20% alpaca chunky. And you can knit it in any of the beautiful indie dyed yarns of your choice. But if you were looking to bring in some of the more conservation breeds, rare breeds, primitive breeds, aside from Icelandic, but you weren't ready to kind of go whole hog, you know, rah-rah, North Ronaldsy, which putting that next to your skin can always be an interesting adventure. Then I was thinking, I went over to Blacker, and they have a beautiful blend of BFL from the north of Wales, from flocks up there, and a Hebridean or Manx fleece. So you retain that BFL, which is a very familiar fiber. It's making its way into the general market. People are starting to use that pretty regularly. And you can just throw a little conservation in there, throw a little rare in there, and watch how that fabric changes. So that might be a way to work with and not take as huge a risk if you're new to the primitive or conservation breed realm. That's a chunky weight. I believe it's a 2-ply. So I thought that might be kind of fun. I haven't had my hands on it, but the Blacker yarn that I have worked with, I absolutely adore, and I think that they're doing such good work over there in Britain. The other thing I thought about for an American yarn would be Imperial Yarn Soft Spun Singles. And this really is a soft spun single. It's very similar to the concept of a Lopi. It almost looks like it could go through the spinner again. And this is Columbia wool. So it's a breed specific yarn and it's an American breed. And again, I think that loftiness might be really fun to work with in this cowl setting. So try to cover the gamut of some conservation rare breeds, an American breed, and then the Icelandic Lopi, just because I love Iceland, and or Icelandic sheep, which goes without saying, because I have four. So that, I thought the cowl offered a lot of opportunity to kind of play around with substituting some rare breed yarns. The tangent pattern, which is a mitts pattern, is worked from the cuff up with integrated thumbs. The tangent mitt plays with the idea of angles and curves. Columns emerge from the twisted rib and curve around the thumb before being folded back into the top rib. Meanwhile, the back of the hand is worked on the bias to the rest of the mitt, knitted in a light DK or sport weight. So mitts can go either way, right? You get a ton of wear, you want lots of tensile strength, or you want something cushy because you're driving, or they're, you know, for walking around and getting, getting to the bus stop or what have you. But this is really the opportunity to kind of go whole hog, like North Ronaldsy, Hebridean, something that's really out there, you know, that even has some Kemp in it. Because I don't know, my hands aren't as sensitive as perhaps my neck. And so here you can do a little bit more with yarns that may pique your sensitivities. However, I have wanted to work with Dovestone DK by Bahram U for a while. And I thought, well, this might be a really fun project to do in their new yarn, which is a Wensleydale, Masham, and BFL. And there again, I'm bringing that BFL in. It's a little familiar. But I've also got the Wensleydale rare conservation breed. Both of those are long wool breeds and have a lot to offer for tensile strength. I also love the color palette of that Dovestone. The other one I thought about was Jill Draper Mohonk, which is a Cormo. So two ends of the spectrum. The Cormo is going to have a shorter staple, more loft, a little bit more cushy. And then you're going to have the Wensleydale BFL. So kind of a continuum to work with, just on your desirability. So for me, my half mitts will often be underneath a full mitt. So my half mitts tend to be more of a tensile, worsted prepared, and then my mitts tend to be more, sorry, my phone went off. My mitts tend to be more loft, right? So I got my warmth going on. I need to take off my mitts to pick up wood, to do work, you know, whatever it is I'm working on, put my mitts back on without losing that heat. So that's a little bit more technical and pragmatic maybe into what yarns and fiber I should be using for my mitts, but just a little bit of thought for you to consider. So I was really psyched about these three and the diversity of where you could go within one collection. And I thought that it was an interesting and compelling theme to use to design. But again, I'm more interested in what am I gonna knit with? If you are just getting into the realm of exploration of these types of yarns, you know, and what I mean by these types of yarns, I mean conservation, rare breed, small producers, etc., I would recommend taking a look at Blacker Yarns, Tolt Yarn, which is a fiber shop in Carnation, Washington, but they have a very nicely curated online shop, and you can see some smaller producers and some micro mills that you might be able then to springboard off, call that producer directly, find other websites, etc. I know sometimes that finding resources can be somewhat challenging unless you're going to festivals, etc. So I think Tolt does a nice job pulling that together, as does Blacker, which is of course all their own milled yarns and blends. I think that's everything I have to say about Katia's collection. I hope that felt worthwhile. I know for me, you know, I don't really want to talk about the aesthetic because what appeals to you may not appeal to me, vice versa. So this again is available on Ravelry as both individual patterns and an ebook. And thank you so much, Katia, for letting us have the opportunity to take a look at the patterns and discuss them and dream a little bit about what we might knit out of them. So this piece is going to be about Shackleton and the knit along, craft along, spin along, weave along, sew along, whatever it is that you're choosing to make in an adventure. A quick update on myself. I have been trying to get to StarCraft, and I happen to be coming down with something, I believe. And so I was supposed to go this weekend, but I didn't want to spread the love and start working on the Shackleton base. But Jannie and I of StarCraft are committed, and so we're hoping to either make next weekend work or find some February time to get that the sampling done and start getting that yarn ready. So my Shackleton is moving forward. It may be a little bit of extended Shackleton-esque, where I may have to find another exploration to do the next part, which is to knit the Frosted Midnight Sweater by Kate Davies. But that's what adventures are, right? I mean, they're about evolving and growing and unfolding. And so that's what this has been. And so I hope that you as well have embraced that piece of adventure. Even though you started out with X, this is my plan, things go awry, and now we're doing this. So it's not a reason to jump overboard. It's a reason to embrace what's come before us. So that's where I am in my Shackleton. We do have some finished objects, which I'm really excited about. So some of you have commented on them in the thread. I'm talking about Rachel of Welford Pearls and her beautiful shawl. I have a little bit of trouble pronouncing that name correctly, but I'm going to give it a shot. But let me go give you, I'm going to give you a picture of this thing. So this was hand-prepped fiber, hand-spun, and then hand-knitted into something absolutely stunning. The design is by Annie Rowden, and it is the Snoqualmie. I want to be able to say it right. And my friend in Washington and my friend from who has relatives in Washington is like gritting their teeth right now, as many of you might be. Now, some things I can say great. This just doesn't happen to be one of them. So let me show you a beautiful picture of Rachel and her finished project. This is actually in my queue as well. I'll just give you a minute with it. Again, it's by Annie Rowden, which I think her publishing name is Annie Claire. Snoqualmie? We'll go with that. I like the, at least it flowed off the tongue. And Rachel does talk a lot about that particular project on her podcast, Woolen Spinning. But I've opened up the finished objects thread in the Ravelry group for Shackleton because people are starting to finish some of their projects within projects. And so if you are building a repertoire, go ahead and post those pieces that you finished. I know that another member of our group has finished one element of her project. I'll see if I... She did a hand-spun, hand-knitted pair of socks. And it's Irbirio. And these are part of her finished Shackleton project. And again, gorgeous, absolutely stunning hand-spun work. It's planning and the sitting. And I say sitting, I mean the being present with the project and the time. So awesome. And it's been really inspiring for me to get onto my spinning wheel for sure. This is a Cheviot hand spun, 285 yards, 73 grams. So congratulations to both of you. And go ahead and post those finished objects in the thread. And if you have a finished object, feel free to post that in the thread. We've had a number of people decide to join along. And I'd like to definitely extend an invitation to join, even if you think you're too late. It's not. It's an open forum. And really, I think what it's evolving into is an opportunity to just talk and chat and support each other as we kind of take on new things and rally the endurance to stick with something epic. So thank you so much for all of the chatter in there and all of the support.
So as part of the Shackleton craft along, make along, I do offer morale boosts because I'm not necessarily giving prizes for finished objects.
I've found that I really enjoy the camaraderie in the chatter thread, and so I draw a morale boost from that thread, and this week is being sponsored by Kimbuck27, or I should say this particular morale boost, and I'm going to let Kimbuck27 negotiate her morale boost for our winner. So I will put the two of you in contact, and then you can see what the big surprise is. Let's see. I did draw on camera, but then there was like all of this lag time. So I thought I'll just re-record that and it'll be nice and quick. So Isabel was the winner. It was thread number 245. And so congratulations to you. I hope you feel boosted. It was interesting because that particular post was replying to Kimbuck27, who she had just welcomed Isabel to the group. So I thought that was a really nice synergy that happened there. So congratulations to Isobolt. I will get you guys in touch. So if you go ahead and PM me on Ravelry, and I'll talk to Kimbuck27 about what our big surprise prize morale boost is going to be. I know it's a pattern. I just haven't figured out if Kimbuck2 has a 7, has a particular idea in mind, and I didn't want to overstep my bounds. So we'll consult with her. We'll make sure you get your pattern and keep up the great chatter, and we'll draw again.
Making part of our Shackleton along, and there's been some beautiful projects as were highlighted, but I wanted to just enrich our experience a little bit with the experience, I should say, of Shackleton and his crew, which is really the inspiration for the work that we're doing. I had left off with the Endurance meeting an ice pack and was going to be frozen in, and this is kind of where the Endurance is lost. And according to reports, and this I'm taking off of southpole.com, by the 19th of January, the Endurance was solidly frozen in. A sounding was taken which found them in 312 fathoms, finding mud, sand, and pebbles. Quote, icebergs hang upside down in the sky. The land appears as layers of silvery or golden cloud. Cloud banks look like land. Icebergs masquerade as islands, end quote. The ship was now drifting southwest with floes. The ship's rudder became dangerously jammed on the 21st from the heavy ice, which had to be cut away with ice chisels constructed from heavy pieces of iron with 6-foot wooden handles. Just before midnight on January 24th, a crack developed in the ice some 5 yards wide and a mile long, only 50 yards ahead of the ship. The crack widened to a quarter of a mile by 10 a.m. on the 25th, and for 3 hours, Shackleton tried to force the ship into the opening with engines at full speed ahead and all sails set. The only result was a clearing of the ice from the rudder. Later in the day, Crean and 2 other men were chipping away at a large chunk of ice that had lodged under the ship, when suddenly the ice broke away, shooting upward and overturning, pinning Crean between the ice and the handle of an 11-foot iron pincher. He only suffered from some bad bruises, but the thick iron bar fared worse. It had been bent against him to an angle of 45 degrees. The days that followed were uneventful. On the 27th, Shackleton decided to put the fires out. They had been burning coal at the rate of 0.5 ton each day, in order to keep steam in the boilers. With only 67 tons remaining, representing 33 days steaming, no more could be afforded as they remained stuck in the ice. Land was sighted to the east and south when the horizon was clear. By the 31st, the ship had drifted 8 miles to the west. James and Hudson rigged the wireless in the hope of hearing the monthly transmission from the Falkland Islands. Nothing was heard. The sun, which had been above the horizon for 2 months, set at midnight on February 17th. On the 22nd, the Endurance reached the farthest south point of her drift, touching the 77th parallel of latitude in longitude 35 degrees west. The summer was gone. Temperature fell to negative 10 Fahrenheit at 2 a.m. on February 22nd. Shackleton wrote, quote, I could not doubt now that the Endurance was confined for the winter. The seals were disappearing and the birds were leaving us. The land showed still in fair weather on the distant horizon, but it was beyond our reach now, and regrets for havens let lay behind us were in vain. We must wait for the spring, which may bring us better fortune. If I had guessed a month ago that the ice would grip us here, I would have established our base at one of the landing places at the Great Glacier. But there seemed no reason to anticipate then that the fates would prove unkind. My chief anxiety is the drift. Where will the vagrant winds and currents carry the ship during the long winter months that are ahead of us? We will go west, no doubt, but how far? And will it be possible to break out of the pack early in the spring and reach Vahassel Bay or some other suitable landing place? These are momentous questions for us. End quote. On February 24th, ship routine ceased. The Endurance became the winter quarters.
As for Shackleton, I had a couple ideas. I'm probably blending a whole bunch of different edited pieces here together because the podcast has not gone as gracefully as I had hoped. But this particular idea was to do a swap. It started out obviously inspired by Shackleton, because there's such a group of us chatting and exchanging ideas, and it seemed like a natural leap to have some sort of tangible exchange. But I think anybody in the group who wants to participate should certainly feel welcome. I was contacted by Lachan Amama, who is Amy on Ravelry and a member of the group, even while I was thinking about a way to connect people in the Shackleton project. And I was thinking of doing a postcard swap or some type of pen pal letter. And I liked the idea of using the mail and that type of thing because that felt very Shackleton to me, letters home. And, which of course they weren't able to do, but. And Amy gave me some ideas for some themes. And one of them was protocol or home. And I thought that was very much in line with kind of what I was thinking. So I'd like to do a swap reflective of that idea, right? So your home harbor, your home port, and we'll exchange something from those two geographic areas. Landscape's always been important to me with my fiber and my craft, and I thought that would be best exemplified in this swap as well. I don't want to outline it, highlight it, organize it right now, but I wanted to just see if there was a general interest to do it before I put some work into it. So I'm going to open up a little thread, and if you're interested in participating, please go ahead and just put yourself down, and you should be willing to participate nationally and internationally. So, you know, if you live in the United States and you're paired with somebody in Australia, or if you live in Australia and you're paired with somebody in Australia. So that's just going to be how we do it. And that's kind of the fun. So just have that in the back of your head, but go ahead and put yourself in that thread if you're interested. And then I will organize something hopefully, cause we'll have interested parties. So that swap will be happening. And I think that was really it aside from my discussion of Shackleton, the finished objects, the swap, and then I have included at the very end, for those of you that are interested, a very brief synopsis of where Shackleton is between now and kind of February, the middle of February. But I think I've covered everything. I did want to highlight a couple podcasts, one in particular that is participating in the Shackleton Along, which is the Victorian Studio podcast. She's a lot of fun. She's out of Winnipeg, Canada. She's working on her first sweater, and it's cabled. She discusses that. And she also has some fun giveaways and knit-alongs and projects that she's doing. So go on over and take a look at Victorian Studio podcast and get a little flair for Winnipeg. I was in Winnipeg when I was traveling to Churchill, Manitoba, and took the train into Winnipeg from Churchill. I was supposed to take the train out of Winnipeg, but I missed it because of flight, so I had to fly to Churchill, which was interesting. The other one is Chickenwood Studio Podcast, and that is with Piper Mom, who's on Ravelry and a longtime fan of the group and supporter of Fibertrek. And she's fun. She does lots of different things. She spins and makes soap, and she has she just has a really nice tune in, see what's happening kind of way about the podcast. So that's Chickenwood Studio Podcast. And those are two that I wanted to just throw out there for you. There are tons, and I watch them, and I have just started, which is so great, to write things down so I know to refer back to them. Hey, look at that. All right. So I think that's really it for those bits and pieces. And then, so I know we did not do acquisitions and discoveries, but I got some books for Christmas, and I just didn't want to do the review and then talk about the books. I'd like to talk about those books almost like a review. And excuse me, I didn't get any fiber that I can remember. So I think I'm just going to do Shackleton, the review, whips, that type of thing, and I'll bring in some of those acquisitions and discoveries next time. So until next time, I hope that you have the opportunity to enjoy the best of the season, and I will see you soon. Farewell.